A very good afternoon to everyone. Well, this seems to be the most interesting part of the sessions in the afternoon, because water is something that will wake you up, if not other topics. And hopefully we'll not take more than 40 minutes. We've been asked to like, cut back on the session and also the individual times that have been allocated, which was earlier 5 minutes. And I request all the speed talkers and the panelists to stick to somewhere between 3 to 4 minutes. To start with, the organizers have given us like 3 broad topics to touch upon. One is the groundwater conundrum, which is about the access to groundwater and inaccess to groundwater in the mountain terrains. And then 2 is exploring the traditional water harvesting practices, which has been here for centuries, and how that can be revived, tapped, improved upon in the context of changing waterscapes and in the climate change. And the 3rd broad topic that has been allocated to us to discuss is about options for water purification, filtration options in remote areas of the Eastern Himalayan region. This is kind of very much linked with the previous session, which is about access to energy as well. Because filtration technology essentially requires energy, and then it's kind of linked with energy access. So I'll just take about 2-3 minutes to broadly brush through the topics in the Eastern Himalayan region. The Eastern Himalayan region is very new to me. I'm lucky to be an advisor for a couple of PhD students who have been quite actively working in the region, and that has given me an opportunity to like go through the various issues related to the region, including water, climate, and livelihoods. So rightly, the rural futures in this particular region is so relevant, because the 70% of population here, of the total 600 million, is mostly in the rural areas, and roughly just about 45% of that total geographical area is arable, which kind of leaves us with very, very low, probably the lowest per capita land holding in entire India, which is roughly less than half of an acre per capita in the region. And that is for that 45% of total population, which depends on agriculture primarily. So coming down to agriculture being dependent on water, conventionally most of the traditional water harvesting practices have been the main source of irrigation in the region. I was just going through some of the literature. Dong Bandh is one of them, which has been mentioned in one of the talks earlier in the morning. That's in Assam, Boroland. And then I saw numerous amounts of these traditional water technologies, including Zaba, Ruza in Nagaland, Khul, Khatir, Apatani. There are about some 50, 60 different traditional technologies that have been adopted in order to like harvest the rain, harvest the flows in the rivers, streams, store them, and then use them for both agriculture and for domestic uses. And quickly to turn to the issue of groundwater. Groundwater has been a major contentious issue across India, but in this particular region it has been also a bit of a puzzle, because though there's plenty of groundwater, primarily that gets recharged from the more than 1,500 millimeters of annual rainfall, but much of it is not easily tappable because of the fragile geology of the region, and then also because most of it is not available throughout the year. So that's left with big challenges to provide domestic and drinking water for the regions in the upper hills and then the mid slopes, which kind of temporarily depend upon springs. And then the lower valley regions, which probably have a lot more options because you have rivers and streams, and then also a lot more spring water that flows down from the upper elevations. So the challenge for us is to look at how these existing biophysical challenges, because of the erratic rainfall, the limitation of the monsoon, the limitations of the topography, and the newer challenges, which are the ones that we have made it for ourselves, which are the large developmental projects which have been proposed, which have been going on. The total estimated hydroelectric potential of this region is somewhere around 100,000 megawatts, and that's a mind-blowing number. If one can think about what a megawatt can do, 100,000 megawatts, this is massively huge, of which about 25,000 is already under construction or under operation. So that's just a few of the challenges that are facing this region over and above the climate change, which is going to completely change the equation. And I believe the session after is going to touch upon the details of the impacts of climate change and what the whole climate game is about, making water available in the context of climate variability and climate change. And that leaves us with the issue of water for biodiversity and ecosystems, which needs a whole different lens and a whole different range of solutions that we need to find out to balance the human needs and ecological needs and the biodiversity conservation requirements as well. With those words, I'm going to close and then request co-chair to.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivasan. Can I have the slideshow, please? The presenter, please. Oh, thank you. Thanks to Balipara Foundation for bringing rural water access into focus and including it in the agenda of EHNF 2017. I always like to start with the blue marble. This was the photograph of the Earth taken from halfway between the moon and the Earth during the last Apollo mission. So it's like water everywhere, but not a drop to drink. The immortal lines from the rhyme of the ancient mariner, penned by Samuel Taylor Coleridge in the late 18th century, seems to be coming true for communities around the world and around India as water emerges as a local issue of global climate change. So at Walk for Water, we have decided to make it our business to address the issue of water accessibility. So we are a civil society, and our mission is to ensure universal safe water access. The United Nations now recognizes drinking water as a right, and it is not a privilege. At Walk for Water, our vision is to bring clean drinking water to India, one village at a time. And we realize that almost half of all these projects about providing water fail due to the lack of community involvement. So you cannot escape community, it is there everywhere. So we set up these community water centers with technological support from Smart India, which is a Hyderabad-based company dealing with all kinds of water services. And this community water center is our flagship program, and we have set up around 8,500 of these across the most parts landscape of India, particularly states of Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, and also parts of Tamil Nadu and Gujarat. So using a combination of all these various processes, sometimes depending on the requirement of the particular area, we use four of these or sometimes just three of these, we provide water at very, very cheap rates that is very affordable to the rural people that we address. And it is always a community-owned asset. So we first identify the villages, we test the water quality, then the community that will work with us. The U here represent the support that we require. So sometimes it's a CSR, company CSR that we look at to support us, and sometimes it is the local area development fund of parliamentarians as well as the legislators. So we are looking to build up on our program and take it across the country. And what we need is a self-sustainable system, which we are trying to provide by including the local communities and the local governments, and of course coordination. This is an example of a community water center. We have these across the rural landscape, and also in some cities like Bangalore and Hyderabad, where water scarcity has emerged as a problem as well. So this is clean water at 20 paisa per liter. You can see people lined up in the inside of a community water center. Currently, we partner with several state governments representing various political parties, as you can see on the right. So as you see, it's mostly Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, which of course has seen the most number of farmer suicides because of drought, and also Bihar and Karnataka. A couple of case studies just to see the how community water centers has worked. The dissolved salt has decreased, so it is almost as good as bottled mineral water, even better sometimes. Another case study. So there are millions of stories like these to be replicated across India, and I invite all the companies here, as well as any politicians and other workers, to partner with us as we try to bring happiness to millions and millions of people across India. We also have this water ATMs, which we hope will eventually replace bottled water, especially in bus stands and railway stations and all that. So just going back to that, this is a case of a social enterprise that we are trying to promote also. It's called the 99K social entrepreneurship. We try to provide opportunity to villagers to actually become water entrepreneurs by just investing just 99,000. We also promote rainwater harvesting all the while, and these are just examples of the models we use. Restoration of borewells, we have done about 20,000 of them restored by our team of engineers. Some of the awards and recognitions won by Walk for Water and the Smart India team. We believe that every drop counts, and therefore we also embarked on a mission to propagate the water pledge, and this has now become a big part of our, it has reached across the country. A lot of the well-known people, the forest man of India, the water man of India, the railway minister who happens to hail from Assam, a lot of celebrities, cricketers, have all actually joined us as we have taken this water pledge across the country and across the world. This year on World Water Day, that was 22nd March, we had participation from 100 countries, including all the 7 continents. And top left, you see the water pledge being administered at Antarctica. And we also reach out to various campuses around the country and help to motivate youngsters, come up with local solutions for the problem, water problem. It's a global problem, but we always need local solutions. So this is our investment in the next generation. This is the water pledge. If we have time at the end of the session, perhaps we could do a quick round. It just takes 1.5 minutes, 2 minutes, but we'll wait for the end of the session to continue. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nitharaj. Now we'll start with the speed talks. The first one is Rinan Shah from ATRI. She's a PhD student. She's from this region, and she'll be talking about her work in the Darjeeling region.
Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to start with a question asking, do you plan your day around the ways in which you could procure water for your daily use? Most of us in this room have the benefit of turning the tap on and always being certain that water will gush out from it. It is something which we seem to take for granted as we groggily turn on the tap to refresh ourselves every morning. However, there are large sections of the society who do not have access to a formal water supply. And water being a very essential need in our lives, procuring water is the primary activity around which these sections of the society plan their activities, be it foregoing the educational opportunities or the economic opportunities. The Eastern Himalayan region is one such region where access to formal water supply is non-existent or at the most intermittent. I carried out a brief survey among the residents in Darjeeling, where the state, in the form of the municipality, provides private as well as public taps, and the respondents mentioned how they need to synchronize their daily activities with the timings of the public taps, for if they miss it, the little water that is sent to the taps by the state would get lost. Acquiring a private tap connection in this region is expensive. The costs can be attributed to the difficult terrain, the lack of physical space, and the difficulty to produce all the necessary documents to provide their residents. Apart from these, the actual cost of installing a connection is also formidable for an ordinary resident in, for example, Darjeeling town. My study shows that the cost of getting a connection to the formal supply is about rupees 17,000, which is exclusive of the labor and supplies charges, which can bring the total to around 60 to 70,000 rupees per household. Even accessing natural springs has its own set of problems. Earlier, it is said to have been more in number, but now have been decreasing steadily, both in number as well as the volume they provide. This could be due to increasing urbanization, increasing population, or climatic changes. In Jawahar Basti in Darjeeling, the wait time for a spring in their vicinity, since people moved into this locality, has increased from around 5 minutes to 5 or 6 hours. And for every turn that one gets, there is a cap on the amount that one can fill, and which is usually around 60 liters. And the turns for filling waters among the residents of the locality sometimes comes once in 2 days. Before I talk about the geography and climate of the region, I would like to point in to this fact that water has been declared as a human right, and it indicates that fresh water is a legal entitlement. Also in India, the right to water is not a separately defined right, but is derived from the right to life under Article 21 of the Constitution. So once we move out from a settlement focus and look at the entire geography and climate of the region, it brings in another aspect of the problem. The region as a whole is considered a water-rich region, but volumetrically. However, this region characteristically experiences a water paradox, water scarcity in a volumetrically water-rich region, a phenomena which can aptly be called a too much or too little syndrome. It has been characterized as a region with the highest per capita and per hectare availability of water in the country. This categorization only looks at the rainfall, population numbers, and the area of the region. This labeling excludes the political, economic, and institutional drivers that lead to the reality of water scarcity. It also fails to address the entitlements and well-being of communities at a household level. Previous studies that have looked at this issue have ignored the drivers of what have led to water scarcity and have started off from a pre-existing condition of water scarcity and have gone ahead with suggesting solutions or studying adaptations to it. But I find it important that in order to understand and therefore resolve a problem, it is necessary to look at the context that created the problem in the first place. Therefore, my study will assess how water scarcity is created using biophysical, economic, institutional, and political factors from a human development perspective. In order to achieve this, I shall undertake an assessment of the region's development trajectory, the various investments in the water sector, and the biophysical problems that have contributed to water scarcity, as well as the perspectives of the communities. The Eastern Himalayan region exhibits a low level of development, and of the many problems that need solving, access to reliable water sources is essential, as it helps in improving the value chain and creating sustainable livelihoods. Access to reliable sources of water, a basic necessity, is every human's right, is an indicator of overall development of a region. Resolving this problem through a better understanding of the issues would subsequently lead to a better performance in the development sector, such as education, livelihoods, and healthcare. Thank you.
When I reached Darjeeling for my intensive retreat, I was surprised by the number of water tankers supplying water to the residents of the town, even in the mid-monsoon. As I started my survey on natural springs of Darjeeling, I spoke to many people from the municipality, engineers, NGO, ATRI colleagues, and general public. I learned that the current water system of Darjeeling was meant for the 10,000 population only. The distribution system is equally old and small. The supply-demand equation is severely stressed in the dry periods before the monsoons. With the underdeveloping infrastructure, I wonder how many people could get pipe water in their houses and learn that 50% of the pipe got and 50% are dependent on the natural springs. A report by intern from ETRI found 32 springs within the Darjeeling municipality area. My guide Manish and I walked the land and bread of Darjeeling town and the surrounding rural areas looking for natural springs that serve as a lifeline for many people. We recorded 52 springs within Darjeeling and surrounding rural areas. Unfortunately, only 21 were active while 31 were dry. I visited communities dependent on these springs and found that most of the people were poor migrant workers from outside Darjeeling, laborers and live like slum-like conditions. Their only source of getting water are the springs. For springs, I wonder how they were managed, whether some people got further excluded in these areas. When I visited the springs, I came to realize that the springs were managed by Samas, which literally means society. All these institutes were informal with unwritten laws and rules. The aim of the Samas was to provide equal access to all the household dependent on the springs. All the household living around and using water from the springs are member of a Samas. Member of each Samas elect a leader for 5 years. This is usually a senior male member. I did not come across a single woman leader, even though it is the women who collect water and manage various household activities around water use. Members collect water from these springs based on a quota usually specified by time. This could be during the morning or night. Activities like bathing, washing clothes, washing utensils, etc. were prohibited in the springs. However, during the stress season, these were a violation of a rule of use. Excess issue in water quality and quantity in rural sites around Darjeeling. During my survey, many told me that there was an increasing demand for water as the population in the locality increased. Population increase was due to the migrant from the plain and from neighboring countries as seasonal laborers. I have seen water vendors taking water from the source of some of these springs to sell water in the town. Thus, the users of the natural springs suffer as the water is diverted to the urban areas. Urban users further affect the price of water because they are willing to pay a large amount to fulfill their demands. I saw women and girl children waiting for around 2 hours in queues for water, which is a gross loss of productive time. I also saw Samas members who do not get access going to nearby streams for washing. These streams are drained for sewage outlet. Before I finish, I would like to leave these thoughts, which is true for the hilly region of Northeast India. Dry springs need restoration so that more water becomes available for the marginalized communities. Perhaps learn from Sikkim Dharavikas program. There is also a tragedy of commons where management system lack enhancement from government and non-government sector. Thus, critical resources are managed in an ad hoc manner. Lastly, natural springs are not under the purview of the municipality nor panchayat, or resources are vulnerable for capture, degradation and exploitation. Thank you.
And now we would like to invite our distinguished panelists for the roundtable. I would like to first invite Dr. Indira Khurana. She is a policy lead, resource scarcity, food security and climate change expert with the IPD Global Private Limited. She has a PhD in biochemistry. She's been working in this region for more than 20 years in issues such as water resource management, biotechnology, rural development and livelihoods. She has worked with Science and Center for Science and Environment, Expo Oxfam, Aragon Foundation and several other distinguished organizations.
Then you have Prakash Datta, who needs no introduction. He was a panelist earlier.
Our third panelist is Dr. Sonali Ghosh. She's an IFS cadre, a director with the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation Mission. She has a master's in forestry and wildlife sciences, diploma. Is Dr. Ghosh in today for the panel? Yeah, doesn't seem like she's around. So we'll go to the next panelist. The next panelist is Minister Sarath Chandra Das. He's with the Grameen Development and Finance Private Limited, India. He's worked on projects with microfinance operation and then has vast experience from the field to policy making in microfinance. Welcome. And our last panelist today is, he's been already on several panels earlier today, Mr. Shankar Venkateshwaran. He's probably had too much, but. Yeah. So, Dr. Khurana, Dr. Datta, and Dr. Das. So the three topics that we have in front of us to debate around and try to find answers to these challenges is the issue of water security in the region. How do we find solutions to the challenges that we face in terms of water, access to water, and then access to purification technology in the remote areas of East Himalayas? Please, Dr. Tata, can you start?
One of the issues with being able to provide water in remote, underdeveloped areas is essentially one of distribution. Many rural communities may have access to clean water, but often it involves considerable physical effort in trying to access that water. So if we could come up with precipitation-based technologies rather than groundwater-based technologies, this could probably be an alternative. For example, we have seen designs where just condensation is being exploited. So you could have a system where high humidity areas are fitted with precipitators. The precipitators just pass through an air tunnel. You are creating a difference between the ambient temperature and in doing so, you are actually just passing the water through the ground. These kind of systems can work without electricity. They could generate daily fresh water for use. They eliminate the use of transportation, distribution. In India, for example, if you are working in public water distribution, you may end up purifying at a central area where, for example, you're removing iron. But then the distribution network is one of iron pipes, which are not replaced and are rusted. So many a times the water reaches the end user contaminated all over again, though the process is being followed. So an alternative could be to try and come up with zero electricity-based water solutions, which are dispersed, and ones where the end user is the producer, rather than have intermediaries who are providing water. So I think with the high humidity and the high rainfall that this area has to offer, water precipitation is a largely ignored technology. The other advantage of such technologies, especially in our part of the world, is that many a times water, when available, does come with a fair amount of heavy metal impurities which require further removal. For example, it could be fluoride, it could be high traces of iron. So precipitated water stored in steel vats, which practically ensures that the equipment will last for about 20, 30 years. And even at that point of time, if you wanted to salvage it, you could probably get the same price of stainless steel in the market, you know. So I'm a big believer in dispersed water solutions, and I think that is something which has been ignored by this part of our world. Mr. Chairman.
Before I move on to the next panelist, Dr. Indira Khurana, I have a question. Is rainwater drinkable? Is it potable directly? Could you please address that as well?
That's why I'm not a great proponent of technology. So I think one of the first points we have to realize is the symbiotic relationship between biodiversity and water. You can't have one without the other. And in the morning, we've had a lot of discussions about biodiversity conservation. We also need to know that that's not possible unless you have water, and vice versa. When we talk about water, we need to look at two issues. One is the whole issue of water scarcity, and the other is the issue of water quality. When you talk of water scarcity, I mean, we'd be surprised to know that the whole of Northeast is susceptible to drought. And in fact, this year after the monsoon, Assam, would you believe it, and Meghalaya have got rainfall in the Normandy too. And 60% of India is suffering from drought after this monsoon. So it's really important to be careful on how we value the water and how we conserve the water. Another issue of concern here is, and some of us speakers spoke in the sessions before this session, was the whole number of dams that are proposed in this region. What I could understand is that 130 dams have been proposed for this region, and one of the latest was one proposed by Niti Aayog in Arunachal, where the Arunachal government didn't want it, and the Niti Aayog was saying that it's going to give you crores of rupees, but it was going to come at the cost of the other tribes. And the Arunachalese were saying that, do we really need that kind of money? When we talk of water quality, 20% of habitations in the Northeast suffer from some kind of water quality issue. So that is something that needs to be addressed. And it's also important to realize that the impact of poor water quality is intergenerational. We have very high levels of anemia amongst the women in India and here, which gives rise to low birth babies who are not able to develop to their full physical and mental capacity. So it's really important that we drink proper quality water. Coming to some of the positives and what we can do, I think it's really important to re-establish the relationship between people and water. Again, in a session before, you know, people were saying that there's no connect with the, you know, with the people and the natural resources. If you can really come around and celebrate water, I think that's the first step that all of us need to take. I'm also agree with what Mr. Dutta said, that we need to look at local water security rather than looking at getting water from far away. And the whole issue of interlinking of rivers, I think, is one which really needs to be explored. And why local water security? Because the need is local. And I remember when we had a kind of a tiff with Pakistan, one of the first things India said was that we were going to rethink how we are going to distribute the Indus, you know, water sharing. When the Jats in Haryana had an agitation looking for more reservation, one of the first things they did was cut off a water supply to Delhi. So it's really important that we look at local water availability, local water sources, local water systems. And just like we have a lot of biodiversity richness, ethnic diversity, linguistic diversity in the region, we also have a huge diversity of traditional water harvesting systems, which was alluded to you in your remarks. So we have good examples from northeastern Himalayas, from the Himalayan ranges, from the Barak and the Brahmaputra Valley. We have from Nagaland, from Arunachal, from Assam. So there are a whole plethora of water conservation systems which were traditionally used, depending on the local ecology. So you had zabo cultivation, you had the very effective bamboo irrigation, where 60 liters of water in the topmost bamboo would actually translate into six drops of water per minute. So you had these kind of systems which were there. It's really important to assess the status of these traditional water harvesting systems and how they can best be revived and used in the current scenario, because things have changed from even 20 years ago. And I hope that Ranjita and Balipara Foundation is listening, because we need to really look at what are the different water harvesting systems that are currently in practice and which can be used in the northeastern region. It's also important to use locally available material and technologies for filtration systems. Prakash also, I think, made a mention of this, and we have a lot of coal here which can be used for natural filtration processes. And we need to revive the springs. There was a mention made of springs in the speed talks. We need to revive the springs, the streams, which were used as good sources of water in earlier days. It is possible to revive these. And coming to your question of whether rainwater is safe to drink, yes, it is, if you take certain precautions into account. For example, if you're doing roof water harvesting, you need to see that the roof is clean. You can put a filtration system in place. you need to let the first rains go, because that, you know, that will wash down all the pollutants in the air, and after that the water can be safe. And if you're still not sure, you can always put in a couple of chlorine tablets for that. Another thing we need to do in the region is look at people-to-people dialogue for transboundary water issues, because it's very contentious. Governments are very reluctant to talk about water. But if civil society can engage in water conversations, I think that will really help in providing water for all in the region. Groundwater, many people have said, is probably not the right idea for here. But I think if you look at groundwater aquifers and try and maintain the balance between surface water and groundwater and see how best we can tap groundwater, I think there is scope for meeting our water demands through groundwater. Partnerships is something, I think in the morning Ranjit mentioned that the foundations got low, but I think if we have good partnerships with like-minded organizations, with technology institutions and with the people, then I think there is a way forward. And lastly, the point I would like to make is that whatever development activities we plan for the region, we need to look at what are the implications for water security. Because I recall in Bundelkhand region, which is historically suffering from drought, there was an investor meet plan there, and more than 70% of the proposals were water intensive. So we really need to look at whatever development program we're having for the region, what does it mean for water resources and water availability for the local people. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kaha. I'd like to just invite Mr. Sarath Chandra Das.
Very good evening to all of you, respected chairs and the panelists, distinguished guests, and ladies and gentlemen. If you see my profile, probably I'll be the least qualified among all the speakers in these 2 days, because currently I run an NBFC MFI, microfinance institutions. So my profile actually does not fit in this forum. But anyway, actually I founded an NGO by name Gramin Sahara, and we have been implementing various projects on livelihoods primarily. And on that, we are also working on water, but not exactly on drinking water, but primarily on irrigation. So I will not indulge myself in giving solutions in the drinking water. I have only one solution, that if anyone wants a loan to buy a filter, I can give a loan. So that is the only solution I have. Actually, see, I think that must have already been discussed about these dong systems. We are also into that, although it is very much in existence in Lower Assam, this Bakska and Nolbari district, but in other parts also it is available. I mean, that those systems are available in Kamrup and Gualpara. So if you see in Bakska, I think around 150,000 farmers, actually lifeline is this dong system. They get water only from that. Here also in Assam Meghalaya border, there are a lot of this kind of dong, and many of them actually we have also renovated. And it has been very, very useful for the farmers without, you know, disturbing anything in the environment or weather or anything else. But unfortunately, there are challenges. Like, you know, if you see those water experts, they will definitely know that now the water level is going down necessarily. And in addition to that, there are many rivers where large-scale sand mining goes on. Large-scale sand mining goes on, and as a result, the bed, the depth of the rivers are actually going down, many rivers in my area itself. So that way, the water level is again going down. And as a result, these dong systems, water not flowing. At time when water level comes up in the rivers during rainy season, then naturally the water comes through the dongs. But when it goes down, when the level goes down, then it becomes again problem. It becomes like a dry kind of canal and there is no water. So during that time again, the farmers have the same problem. they don't have water. In addition to this dong system, we have another system that actually we have in support, with support from Tata Trust, we have implemented a project where we bring water from the hill springs through underground PVC pipes, and those water actually used for various purposes, primarily for how homestead gardening or even agriculture also, those water are used. The natural course, it remains. Actually, the entire water, it does not come only through a PVC pipe. So that natural canal, it remains. Constructing a small shake dam at a certain height, so water is stored, and from there, it is connected via a PVC pipe, and this water comes through, and wherever you want, below that height, you can take the water to any place. Any place, irrespective, even if it is undulated, then also you can take the water to that place. And it again, since it works on gravitational force, we automatically the water comes to wherever you want to take. So we have record that actually currently we are working in 30 villages. We have 30 such infrastructures where we have just constructed these PVC lines. And there, of course, other challenges are there, like for having this kind of structure, the biggest challenge is that it is constrained by the availability of sources. If there is source, then only it is possible. If it is not there, then even if there is no water, farmers are there, you cannot bring water if it is far away. But we have seen that we can bring it up to 5 kilometers. We have brought water up to 5 kilometers. So that has been found to be very, very useful. And what we have seen, that this has not actually affected anything. We have been observing for last 4 or 5 years that plantations and everything is intact. We have not seen, there is no visible changes in terms of plants, trees and all. So it seems that it has not affected anything, because water is, again, as I said, water has continued to come through that natural course. But in last 1 year, we have seen that out of these 30 locations, in one location, the water has dried up. And there is no water coming. So we do not know exactly, because sometimes it is said that water also springs, it changes its course, or it has really dried up. So these 29 locations, wherever we have been, these structures, we are not sure for how long the water will be there and farmers will continue to get the water. So we don't know exactly, because we also don't have any kind of scientific study or some kind of evaluation where from we can know the rate of decrease of water source or all. So we do not have this kind of data. So we do not know exactly for how many years water will be available. So that is also, again, we have also taken care of like planting trees in the upstream, and the villagers, we mostly, although these structures actually, we have not constructed ourselves, because these are all been done by the community, by the community members. So we have not paid anything, only the materials and technical support trainings we have provided, and they themselves have contributed the entire labor. And constructing 4 kilometers, 5 kilometers of canals, they have done themselves. So that way, at the community level, what we have seen that, and there are committees also who regularly save money for repairing if any damage is there. Yeah. So that way, at the community level, actually, it seems that sustainable. But environmentally or ecologically, I do not know whether this will continue for long or not. So this note, I'd like to stop here. Thank you.
So before we go to second round of discussions, I would like to pose one question to each one of the panelists. To Mr. Datta, you've been talking about technology in the earlier session as well, and then you seem to be a big techno-economic promoter. And I completely agree with you that technological solutions are as important as bringing in the governance mechanisms and participation of communities and all other related issues to solve the problem. So what has been the major hurdle to make this technology accessible so far, if it exists?
I'm not clued into that literature or the scientific aspects of it. And the related question would be, there would probably need to be a huge investment push to make these technological options go to the ground, more over and above having access to the technology itself. So what are the different investment options, either from the government programs or from the corporate sector?
With decentralized water, you can have multiple revenue models. One could be, for example, we are talking about how you cannot really be sure when you are boring as to how long the bore will sustain itself. So possibly in Baksa or Udalguri, these districts, you will find many irrigation projects. How they start is that they will initially bore, where it's common knowledge that you should not bore. That's why people use irrigation. So by the time the boring exercise is done, a little bit of water is extracted, but it's not distributed. So initially you will have people queuing up, at least people from neighboring areas, to collect their daily household water. The only reason they would do it is because it actually saves them some amount of labor. Previously they were collecting it from a larger distance. Now, so you have the boring, then you've put in your pump, and in a 2-3 year time frame, the reservoir ultimately is created, which is supposed to store the water, and through gravity is then supposed to pipe it to the entire community. But by then, there are many areas where the water table itself collapses, and this entire infrastructure becomes redundant. So rather than replicating a model which has not succeeded time and again, perhaps, since water is a public health issue, government will have to initially promote more than one method, maybe, of trying to provide accessible water. So it's probably one fit for all does not exist in water, and probably the subsidy initially will have to come from government. We were looking at models like where you could even form a group. The group could be given a loan. The loan provides the equipment. The equipment has a use and a sell model. So part of the sell model could be that you're actually bottling water. And in turn, say, if you have Axis Bank prioritizing a CSR activity. So what I would do is that I would ask Axis Bank to give us some of the money. We would put up these precipitators. The precipitators would in turn provide drinking water to households, and also the opportunity to bottle a part of it. Now, a part of that bottled water can actually be bought back by Axis Bank. This can be branded water. It could be Axis Bank water. And the cost of drinking water in Axis Bank can subsidize the cost of equipment with communities. So there would be multiple approaches that are possible. Government-led programs would naturally have to be subsidy-based, but they need to be more open to adapting different technologies rather than following convention. So with government policy, typically the baggage of convention is objected to. So sure, government has a role to play, but I think corporate social responsibility has a role to play in all of this. And even water distribution companies can have a role to play in the future, because you can always charge the water on a metered basis. So if you are approaching communities who cannot necessarily afford the equipment, well, they can work on a pay basis, because the advantage of setting up such systems in rural areas is that you don't have people who would vacate households. You don't have a migrant population. Anyone there is permanently there. So probably part financing, probably engaging corporate India, probably engaging social groups. I think a combination of these will eventually give an answer.
Thank you, Dr. Datta. My next question is to Dr. Khurana. You've been talking one new topic that we didn't hear across from the other panelists, which is about conflicts and sharing of water, and then having the platform dialogue to share water where these conflicts exist. There has been a long existing debate that we don't have enough laws for resolving water conflicts, and we do have tribunals and the water is shared between states, but we don't have laws to resolve conflicts at the local level, at the regional level,
So for example, in the northeast, when water is shared across smaller river basins which across states. So what do you think is lacking in an even legislative system that could improve these conflicts and provide the platform for dialogue which can reduce the
I think one of the speakers before me also said that water is a human right. I think that's the background on which whatever work we do in water in the region, that's the foundation on which our work should be done. I'll just talk a bit about India. We don't have it as a legal right other than a constitutional Article 21. Water is also on the concurrent list. So certain issues of water are managed by the central government, certain issues are managed by the state government, and then you have the local governments also coming in at the village and the panchayat level. So depending on the scale of the issue or whether it's in between states, you have different platforms for which these conflicts are supposed to be addressed. I'd like to just highlight about when I speak about interlinking of rivers and why I'm really wary about this is that we have these problems of sharing between two southern states and still we are not able to arrive at a solution. And if you talk about the first proposed interlinking in India, which was between the Ken and the Betwa link, which is there in one of the publications here, I think this was proposed more than 30 years ago. And still work for various reasons, thankfully, has not really begun on the interlinking of these two rivers. Which state is going to say that they have enough water, which they are willing to share with another state? That's political suicide, harakiri for them. So they will not do this. And when we're talking about sustainable development goals, which is another point which came up in the morning, which says, you know, water for everybody by leave no one behind by 2030. If you're not even moving forward for this, forget about the environment cost, the financial cost, you know, people are not going to have water security for the next 30 or 40 years or so. So I think the whole thing of interlinking of rivers is something we really need to very, very, very carefully look at. There are various issues when you talk about water, it's highly political. So I think when you have platforms where people talk to each other, where farmers from one state or from one region talk to farmers from another, where women from one place talk to another, I think they're learning, the sharing, the understanding of the problems. I think this is something which is more effective than when you look at platforms which are proposed by, you know, by say legal entities or by the government. So I would strongly urge that we have civil society conversations between states, you know, between different villages, between you know, nations in the region, so that we can arrive at proper solutions which are equitable, which are just, and which take everybody's at least minimum requirements into account. I remember going for a meeting in Kathmandu where there were, you know, participants from different countries. And coming from India, there was a lot of misinformation I found, which was being propagated by, you know, by the other countries. So it's very important to be transparent and to share the information so that we can move forward together with the social justice in
Thank you, Dr. Khan. So in closing, I would like to thank all the panelists for their inputs and then their expert opinions and views. Looking at the issues again, we kind of do agree that so corporate investments, starting with government promoting programs, including the MNREGA or watershed development programs that were like massively promoted in the 80s and 90s, plus microfinance could start up, you know, local innovative ways of investing in these technologies and also decentralized technologies to tap water. And then also water purification. And I hopefully believe that the Indian legal system is going to make some major reforms in the next coming years. I mean, there has been some good news. There has been quite a bit of dialogue within the water community where there are discussions happening between civil society, the planners, on coming up with a water framework directive for all India. So hopefully in the next few years, the dialogue will continue and then we'll end up with some kind of a legal system to protect the rights of communities and then regions, especially regions of Northeast, which are going to tap into the streams and springs, and then the conflicts are probably going to increase over a period of time because the exploitation hasn't been as much so far. But as you keep tapping these resources, conflicts will arise, and then hopefully there will be mechanisms, ways in which we can address those conflicts. And to closed my summary. I would request Rituraj to say a few words about the
We have come to the end of the water access session, so I would like to request everyone to take the water pledge. It will just take a minute before we wrap up the session on water access. Can we please rise in?
We are short of time, so I'm kind of taking the liberty of not opening it up to the public for questions. Please
can
do
I request,
can panelists, I talk to them or tea if you have any specific.
Can I request Ms. Warren, Priyanka, to come and administer the water pledge, please?
I take an oath to conserve water and to use water wisely. I pledge to consume water justly and not waste even a drop of water. I'll treat water as the most precious treasure that I process and consume it. Accordingly, I'm sorry. I pledge to motivate my family, friends, and neighborhoods to use water wisely and not waste it. It is our planet, and only we can save it.
Thank you, Priyanka, and thank you to all the panelists. Thank you very much.